Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Dodla Dairy Limited Q1 FY22 earnings conference call hosted by ICICI Securities. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal the operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Rishab Kapadia from ICICI Securities. Thank you, and over to you, sir. Mr. Rishab Kapadia?
Ladies and gentlemen. Yes.
Sir, please proceed.
Thank you. Lizan, can you hear me?
Yes, loud and clear.
Oh, thanks. Thanks, Lizan. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Q1 FY22 Dodla Dairy earnings conference call. We have with us from the management, Mr. Sunil Reddy, Managing Director, Mr. B.V.K. Reddy, Chief Executive Officer, and Mr. Anjaneyulu Ganjoo, Chief Financial Officer. I would now like to hand over the floor to the management for their opening comments. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Rishab. Hello, everyone. This is Sunil Reddy. A very warm welcome to everyone to the Q1 FY22 earnings conference call of Dodla Dairy. We are actually meeting in a short time since we conclude our Q4 for the year 2021 call post our listing. I hope that everyone is keeping safe and well in the pandemic scenario, and we at Dodla are advising our employees to be extra careful and not to drop their guards should there be a third wave. In my introductory call, I had given a brief outline of who we were and what we do, and I'm not again going to go through the thing because I think it'll bore all of you. I will just go through the numbers straight away. Q1 FY22 was a period where our economy faced the onset of the second wave and triggered lockdowns that impacted many businesses. We also, as the dairy business, had to face some operational and supply chain challenges. We have learned from our first lockdown experience, and we are much better prepared this time around. Despite the headwinds, I am pleased to say that our top line grew by 12.5% on a year-on-year basis, and our average milk procurement was 12.3 lakh liters per day compared to 10 lakh liters per day in the corresponding quarter. Anjan, our CFO, will cover the detailed financials, but suffice to say that we performed incredibly across all key parameters compared to Q1 for the year 2021. As mentioned in the last call, Dodla prides itself on its well-integrated supply chain, managerial expertise, vast operational presence, and a strong branded product portfolio. The performance in this quarter sets the benchmark for this fiscal, and we believe that our focused strategy and execution excellence will hold us in good stead in the coming quarters. We have laid continuous emphasis on quality of all our products with a view to make Dodla name a trusted family name across the length and breadth of the country. To aid this, the company has maintained sustained relation with the dairy farmers, and we continue to deepen our presence in newly entered state of Maharashtra, as well as the unserved areas of opportunity existing in the southern Indian territories. Technology, both in the terms of plant infrastructure and supply chain management, continues to be a focus area for Dodla, and we believe the single-minded focus on use of technology will be a competitive advantage for us in the long run. At Dodla, our commitment to responsible growth has always been central to all we do. A long-held conviction has been that sustainable business would outlast their competitors and provide better long-term successes. ESG practice, therefore, a cornerstone of our growth strategy and one that is founded on compassion, partnership, and inclusiveness. As part of our ESG objectives, we are taking small but definitive steps to transition most of our facilities' operations to renewable energy sources, and I'm proud to say that many of our plants currently already have solar power capacity installed, and all the latest plants that we have built in the past two, three years have also been zero-discharge plants, and we're proactively taking up the step towards the ESG in other areas also. With this brief, I'll hand over now to Mr. B.V.K. Reddy, our company CEO. B.V.K., sir.
Thank you, Sunil, sir. Very good morning to all. As I mentioned earlier by Sunil, this quarter was faced with volatility and supply chain challenges, but we kept our utmost priority on ensuring smooth operation in terms of procurement and timely deliveries for our customer base. Our focus has also been to take in precautionary measures for the both health of our employees and follow local government guidelines while working on site. We continue to build our strong procurement model and we will continue to tweak and develop it this quarter. As a quarter end, we procure milk from 1.2 lakh farmers on daily basis and provide regular direct payment to the bank accounts, approximately 84% of them. This, along with helping them with the financial loans and assisting them with high quality cattle feed through our subsidiary company, Argafeed. This has helped us to create a strong engagement model with them. We carry out collection operations through 7,300 villages, and we are consistently improving our direct procurement model, which stands at approximately 90% as of date. This direct procurement not only enables cost saving, but also helps to build direct relationship with our dairy farmers. In terms of our processing capacity, we have been adding to our existing plants over the years, and we are always on the lookout of new areas. With our ability to access market trends, we have already set up 14 plants with an aggregate capacity of 20 lakh liters approximately as of date. We have 42 sales offices and moved to 12 states as of Q1 22. With our strong network, 1,510 plus milk and milk distributors, 3,100 distributors agents, 455 Dotla retail parlors, we were able to reach customers more efficiently this quarter than the previous, and this is reflected into our top line. Our Dotla retail parlor strategy to expand our footprints in our chosen area in helping to create a brand visibility before the eyes of the country common man. So as we all know, previously reiterated, Q1 22 has been good quarter due to the summer season for the overall dairy industry, and it was one for dairy also. This also reflected in terms of our numbers. However, the second wave of pandemic did impact our out of home consumption revenue, but we built on our experience from the past COVID-19 wave and fared better this time in terms of supply chain distribution, which is clearly reflected in our numbers. Going forward, we will continue to use our expertise for the further expand our extensive network, and thereby we build our procurement processing units, strengthening our brand position as well as expansion of revenue share in the space of value-added products will continue to remain our top priority. Now I will hand over to Mr. Anjan, our company CFO, for the financial end of this quarter.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, everyone. I would like to briefly touch upon the key performance highlights for the quarter for the financial year 2022. And then we can open the floor for question and answer. We have also submitted a detailed presentation of our quarterly performance on the exchanges and also uploaded on our website. Before I proceed, I would request all of you to go through the same and get some insights from it. The operational highlights for the quarter ended June 30th, 2021. Average milk procurement during Q1 financial year 2022 was at 1.3 lakhs liters per day compared to 10 lakhs liters per day in Q1 financial year 2021. Average milk sales during Q1 financial year 2022 were at 8.3 lakh liters per day compared to 7.7 lakh liters per day in Q1 financial year 2021. Curd sales, including buttermilk, lassi, for the Q1 financial year 2022 was at 294.3 metric tons per day compared to 243.2 metric tons per day in Q1 financial year 2021. Revenue from value-added products excluding fat and fat-based products was at 1,399 million INR compared, which contributed 27.8% to the overall dairy revenue during this quarter of financial year 2022. Now I'll take you through the financial highlights for the quarter ended 30th June 2021. Operating revenues were at 5,121 million in this quarter compared to 4,554 million in the same quarter previous year, which is with a growth of 12.5% year over year. EBITDA was at 509 million in this quarter compared to 608 million in the same quarter previous year, with a degrowth of around 16.2% year over year. I can explain in detail later. And profit after tax stood at 361 million in quarter this quarter for financial year 2022 as compared to 322 million in quarter financial year 2021, with a growth of 12%. This has a one-time impact of tax refund in our Lakeside Dairy Limited in Uganda of around 90 million INR, translated to 90 million INR. EPS for this quarter stood at 6.1 compared to 5.8 in the same quarter last year. That concludes the update on financials, which we believe has been positive and has shown a steady growth. We will now open the discussion for question and answers. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin with the question and answer session. Anyone wishing to ask a question may please press star and one on your touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Gaurav Jogani from Axis Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Thank you for the opportunity and congratulations on a good set of numbers. So my first question is with regards to the recovery, I mean, post the pandemic, the second wave. What is your sense of the recovery? How are the sales shaping up? And any sense you can give on that?
This is Sunil here, Gaurav. Thank you very much for coming on to the call. When you look at the COVID pandemic, yes, we did have a steeper uptake during April. We lost out a bit in May because of the fear of the third wave again. And June was also a little steady and going forward. But we think that it is now coming back to pre-COVID levels very quickly. And that's how I think it will go forward. I don't think the third wave impact, unless something substantially comes across, which all of us are not too sure of where is it going to lead to. But if the current status continues and the status quo continues, we should be improving and continuing with this improved sales revenues.
Sure, sir. Sir, did you also witness any gains from the unorganized players, I mean the local milk vendors or any of the small-time players who might have went out of the business during this pandemic, and any new geographies that you might have entered into this particular quarter? If you could highlight that.
So we have entered into, coming to sales, we have done, we don't get into more of the new territories, only the existing volumes that we are getting back, which is growing up. A small thing, we just entered Pondicherry, just to add as a list of a state. If you want, we can add it, because it's a very small thing that we went into. But it's only an extension of Tamil Nadu for us as we look forward to it. But more than that, it's growth as usual. It's a simple thing of B2B in terms of the tea shops opening up a bit, a little bit of the offices opening up, which is the traction that we're getting for our improved sales to come up. And I think if it goes forward and the weather improves also, it will be very strong numbers going forward.
Sure, sir. And one last question from my end is that, sir, we have been witnessing some impact of inflation across, industries in terms of the procurement prices for various raw materials. How has been the trend for us? And also, if you can highlight the procurement price for Q1 FY22 versus Q1 FY21 and your outlook for the way forward.
So Anjum will give you the specific details in a minute. So Gaurav, my view of what we say is, yes, there was a inflationary trend not only on the procurement prices but also because of the fuel prices, which we have been able to sort of contain because of the volume increase that happened. Therefore, you see the slighter corrections that were happening. So with the substantial fuel increase and the little bit of packaging material increase, we have been able to contain it because of the volume growth. Coming to the procurement number specifics for the quarter, Anjan will give it to you now.
So for the quarter ended, for the quarter average, for financial year 2022, we have a procurement rate of around 31.10 paisa, compared to for the same quarter previous year, we were around 30 rupees. So there is around 1 rupee increase in terms of procurement cost. So this is the procurement cost, not the consumption cost.
Sure, sir. And sir, if you can also share the consumption cost also, that will be really great.
consumption cost also in the same line. So from 33 rupees somewhere to 34 rupees, so there is a 1 rupee impact that we have in terms of consumption.
Sure. And so just one last bit as an extension to this. So going to this inflation, you know, in terms of, as you mentioned, in the fuel prices also and a slight bit of procurement prices as well. So are you envisaging any price increases in milk prices going ahead? Anything that you're witnessing in the local area?
So, Gaurav, I don't think right now it is not going to be that much of an impact in terms of we need to increase our milk for selling prices, because I think we can still maintain our margin profile as we're going along. Because like I keep repeatedly saying that, our volumes are going up. Our absolute number in terms of profitability will continue to hold four. And that is what we go by normally, right? What we target as our absolute number of profitability is what we are targeting at. And I think we'll maintain those absolute numbers without a price increase. We'll try to increase our volumes.
Oh, got it, sir. Sure. Thanks. That's all for me.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Bhavan Cheda from Enam Holdings. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Sir, can you give a state-wise breakup of milk procurement in quarter 1 FY22?
Yes, sir. I'll ask Anjan to give the, or BBK to give the water-wise breakup of the quantities by state-wise. BBK, sir.
Yes, sir. See, AP, Andhra Pradesh, we have roughly about 38%. So that is, 4,55,934. And Karnataka, it is almost, 2,13,000. And Tamil Nadu, we have 3,99,000, close to 4 lakhs. And Telangana is 87,000 liters. And Maharashtra is 29,000 liters. Total, India alone, 11,85,000 liters.
Okay. Sure. And I missed out on the milk procurement price. I think the line was not very clear. If you can give again, and what was the quarter 1 FY22 milk procurement prices versus quarter 4?
So it was around the quarter 4 and quarter 1 that you're asking, sir. We gave last time, I think,
Q1 versus Q1.
Q1 versus Q1. Now we'll give you Q4 versus Q1, sir.
So the procurement rate for the Q4 versus Q1 was around 33.40 paisa in Q4, and Q1 we are at around 31.10 rupees. And same Q1 last year we were around 30.10 rupees. So there is a 1 rupee from the previous year, and there is a reduction from the previous quarter because of this lockdowns.
And what is the current procurement price? It's around this only, sir?
Yeah, it's around the same. It might go up marginally here and there depending on the state mix, sir.
Sure. And last call, sir, you had mentioned we were looking at procurement of close to 14 lakh liters in FY22. So how we are on that target, sir?
I think, sir, we have now reached around 12.9 lakh liters where we are procuring. And as we are going into the monsoons in the flush period, it will come up, sir. We'll be opening more chilling centers. So we will be able to increase our volume and we'll reach that.
Okay. And what was
the by the next quarter, you'll see a lot more of the US chilling centers in operation.
Yeah. So what was the curd sales in value in the quarter? I think you gave 294 tons per day. What did it translate into the quarterly revenue?
1 minute. Sir, Anjan will answer that question, sir.
Hi, Anjan here. So for the quarter, the VAP sales were around 1,399 million. So in that, so around 1,240 is from the curd.
1,240.
Yeah.
Okay. And liquid milk prices realized in the quarter was?
Realization of liquid milk prices for the quarter was 1 minute. So Anjan will give you the realization of liquid milk for the quarter of first quarter.
Yeah. So liquid milk realization, I don't have it readily available, but on an average, our realization was around 48.50 rupees versus 47.90 rupees earlier. And yeah, I got for liquid milk, it is 46.40 rupees is the realization.
48.50 rupees, you said, no, sir?
No. 48 rupees is overall, including VAPs, 48 rupees. And for liquid milk, 46.40 rupees around.
46.40 Okay. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. A reminder to the participants, anyone wishing to ask a question, may please press star and one. The next question is on the line of Satish from AFINS Share Services. Please go ahead.
Congratulations, sir, on the very good performance. Like, that gives a lot of confidence to investors as well. Sir, you were mentioning about the direct farmer procurement mix is around 90%. And are we maintaining the same percentage now, sir, or any plans on that which you would like to share?
Satish, thank you very much for the question, Satish. We are planning to reach our 100%. What we mean is 90% of farmer procurement is that they're handling directly from the farmer. The remaining 10% is the older system or the agent system that we have, which we think by the end of this year we're trying to do it, and I think BVK can throw some more light on it.
Yeah, yeah. See, that is also there, you know, we have some tie-up units in the Buffalo area since long time. So very small quantity, see, that is continuing. But going forward, no, since see, once we reach to 14-14 lakhs, you know, this percentage will keep on dilute, and then, you know, DDL percentage will go up.
Yeah. So we should be improving it further.
Yeah, it should be improving further. Maybe next year it will become 95%.
Okay. So any cost advantage you see in direct farmer procurement versus agent or tie-up what you are mentioning just now?
Yes, sir. There will be a cost advantage because you're basically eliminating the middleman and there is a better clarity and visibility. More than the cost advantage, also because of the quality and the clarity that is available in maintaining farmer relationship, it also adds a lot more benefit in growth.
Okay. So if I have to attribute any value to the benefit, any ballpark number you can give us, sir, how much benefit it does generally happen?
I think I know, sir, more about like a thing of saying, yes, it does help us a bit, sir. Specific number, I think I can give it to you offline, sir. We have it with us, but yeah, it does help in terms of, let me say, 3-4% at least, not 2-3% in terms of the paisas of the 40-50 paisas number range.
Yeah, that's fine. I mean, ballpark number. Yeah, because you know, that's a game changer in at least in South India for Dodla. That's how we're a little bit interested.
Yeah, yes, sir. That is this. That is what we are concentrating and trying to improve and make it better.
Yeah. Yeah. Thanks a lot, sir. If I have any question, I'll follow you. Thanks.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sharad Singh, an investor. Please go ahead.
Hello, Sabra. Sir, you mentioned you giving financial assistance to the farmers you procure milk for. So, like, what kind of assistance are these?
Anjan will answer. The financial assistance to farmers is actually a very small thing where loans we don't give. If it is only basically the banks want to give, we act as a collection agent for the banks and we facilitate the services as a third party collection agent. So, we deduct from our milk bill and pay the farmers.
There is no guarantee from the company as such.
No, there's no guarantees from the company as such. No guarantees.
So only for the feed, what they buy is, so we deduct it from their milk bill that we generate. So whoever all the farmers sell the milk to us, so we supply the feed also to them, the animal feed. And in terms of that, whenever we pay the milk bill to them, so we deduct it and pay it to them. So in terms of financial assistance in the feed, it comes as that. And the remaining thing, as Mr. Sunil already mentioned.
Okay. Okay, and sir, regarding the company's distribution network, how does the company look to expand this? I mean, the distribution?
So in sales, we have, BBK will take you more through the details. So we broadly go by three parameters of what we call as our own retail parlors that we are trying to establish and improve our volume through that. And then we have the distributor model that is there, which basically we give it to them, and we have our own direct retail agents. So these are three broad modules that we have, other than the placement in the A-grade stores, which the products do. So that is where we'll be continuously be pushing in all three fronts, sir, with a little more focus on the parlors, our own retail outlets.
Okay. So could you give some light on the margin differential between the three avenues?
I mean, margin difference between them is BVKL.
Not much margin difference between the retail agents and between the distributors. Because, you know, you see in the rural area, mostly in the districts, you know, we have a distributor model. So once you come to Chennai, Bangalore, like cities, you know, we have a agent model. So because people are selling 200, 300 liter kind of, you know, agents. And the district, mostly in the districts, you know, we have a distributor model. So Northern Karnataka, even three type cities. And another one is, you know, DRPs, the Dodla retail parlors.
Mm-hmm. So the cost difference in the retail parlors will slightly be higher, because on an average, whenever we are introducing more new ones, wait for them to stabilize,
yeah.
And it might be marginally higher, but then it evens out. As you see, store on store basis, they're the same. So new stores might be higher.
Okay, so which would be the choice, the best choice for the company to focus on? I mean, the best avenue.
I think we'll take a blend of all, sir. We would try to, we go more by saying wherever there's a different difficulty in penetration, we take the parlors. Where there is easier availability and there is availability of an agent willing to take, we go through the agent model, sir.
So we are trying to go towards, you know, exclusivity.
Through agent and
parlors. Yeah, through agent or even distributor. Mostly, majority of the distributor, mostly, you know, all exclusive. And DRP, you know, anyhow, this is an exclusive model. So we are driving towards that.
Okay. Thank you so much. That's all. Thank you. All the best.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, anyone wishing to ask a question, may please press star and one. The next question is on the line of Shirish Paradesi from Centrum Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi Sunil, hi BVK sir, good afternoon and thanks for the opportunity. I have three questions. The first question is that would you talk something about how the procurement industry is moving? I mean, there are a lot of competition which is entering and most of the players has got limited resources. However, we are targeting the same people who are supplying the milk. How this is competition behaving in your markets in terms of procurement, and any impact in the short term or in a medium term? How do you see this competition behaving, normally or abnormally?
Well, thanks, Shirish. I'll just give a brief outlook, and maybe if details are required, BVK will also pitch in. So competition has been there from whenever we have existed, and now from 95 onwards when we started our operation in 98, it's been there. So the constant improvement is what the challenge is. And improvement is not only on the tech enablement, like we said, we have moved away from the old days where we only stopped the responsibility to the village level collection agent. Now we have moved up to the farmer, and then from the farmer, now we are able to go directly into payment to the farmer methodology. So I think all of us who have been spending time and energy in the technology upgradation, the process of getting it implemented, it's not only the technology of putting a machine in a village, but the follow-up that you follow, see what happens when there is a drop in an agent, try to get that milk back. And doing that at the 365 days of a year is primary. Then second thing that we follow up is to make sure the payment is made on time, that the farmer does not have any issues on that is happening. And third is the facilities that we give, maybe it is cattle feed or some veterinary health or whatever they need. It is a combination of all the three. Who does efficiently, people look forward for it more, and we think we're doing a good job with that in terms of the efficiency that we're maintaining relationship with the farmers and going forward. Yes, price does play a role in it too. So we are very aware of the price and we keep close track of it based on our requirements of what our price is and our ability to convince our farmer community of why we are offering the same. At some places it might be marginally lower where we try to convince them. Some places it will be on par where we are okay with, and that's how we take it forward. And I think we've been doing it reasonably well, and we've been able to hold on to the farmer community as a whole. And wherever we are entering in newer areas also, we are able to attract more farmers because of the system's transparency and our ability to, you know, deliver it on the ground.
Thank you, Sunil. What I meant is that you have a close competition from Heritage and even Hatsune in the same market, and they have similar benefits which is given to the farmer. What I'm trying to understand is this competition is going to behave little differently in terms of procurement price. If that is the constant factor which is going to go faster, will it have some impact on our margins? And that's my follow-up question. How one should look at the margins in the medium to short term?
Yes, sir, because I look at it as, you know, basically we all operate in the similar, you know, procurement and sales margin. There is
Correct.
Not much of a difference that one can offer over the others. So we basically maintain that trend of all of us are almost in a similar boat. Depending on some areas where they are different, it might be marginally different, but no major differentiation coming in pricing, sir. I think BVK is...
There is no problem with Hudson or Heritage, any problem. You know, again, you know, area specific. So if you go to Karnataka, maybe Karnataka is dominated by only Nandini, that is KMF. So Nandini, because they are getting subsidy, they are slightly paying higher. But you know that we are compensating because of our service and prompt payment. Subsidy amount, see, they are paying very late, once in 3 months, once in 6 months. So our payment is, you know, regularly once in 10 days, once in 15 days, you know, we are making. So even there is a 50 paisa, 1 rupee variation also, we were able to attract. So that is there. Or otherwise, you know, we don't have any issue with Hudson or Heritage. So wherever, you know, the subsidies are there, you know, only there, such a places, not all the areas. So Maharashtra, there is no issue. So even in Andhra also, there is no much of issue, even in Tamil Nadu also. There are certain pockets only where, you know, these cooperatives, you know, wherever they are getting subsidy. So slightly we are facing that problem. Or otherwise, you know, there is no problem.
Thank you, Vivekan, sir. But my follow-up is still unanswered. How should we look at the margin in medium to short term?
I think we'll maintain steady state, sir, as we are. We don't see any abnormal blips coming along the way.
Okay. My last question is on CURD. I do understand we have a very strong product and we are increasing and the growth is very, very good. Right now, we are in the range of about 27-28%. Aspirationally, where would you like to have a value-add portion to settle maybe a year or two from now? And do you really intend to spruce up your offering in the HoReCa channel?
I think the HoReCa channel sprucing up is not going to be, I mean, we do it, sir. We are also increasing our presence in A-grade store with the whole bouquet of our other products, including your favorite milks to UHT milk and all that. Curd is the major driver, which we also keep pushing up. In fact, we could have done better, but we lost out a bit on curd because, you know, curd has also got a bit of seasonality to it coming April, May, June, and the, you know, the summer months, the consumptions are higher, which we have lost out on the first quarter of being there. I think the growth that I see personally going forward, we had a reasonably good CAGR. If you look at our past historically, I think the 5-6% CAGR is what we have. But on a conservative side, I rather err on the conservative, being conservative and saying that we will do 2-2.5% at least annual growth in terms of the value-added product increase.
Okay. The reason why I'm asking, obviously what we understand from the channel, the packed curd sales has a higher gross margin, and of course the retail dominance is also going to be present. What I wanted to ask is that if the HoReCa channel is going to be a key area of growth for the value-add products, will it dilute the margin or you will be able to maintain the similar run rate?
Our HoReCa is a very, very small portion of our entire sales. Sir, our sale is almost, I'm just guessing the number which might be variable a little more. But 90-95% for us is B2C. Sir, our HoReCa segment in curve is very small because if you take our packaging sizes, which BVK can explain, we have multiple packaging sizes. And the bigger packaging sizes quantity is, I said, the seasonality of weddings or whatever. Other than that, it's entirely a B2C. So I can give, BBK will give you the break for packaging size and
the packing size, even this HoReCa and a modern trade and all, it will not going to impact. Even see, we've spread across this modern trade and HoReCa also. Because, you know, so our majority of the market is coming from the rural areas and other consumers. So that is year on year it is going, and based on, you know, our network, you know, even this 1-2%, you know, it will not impact overall.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you, sir, and all the best to you and the team.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Gaurav Jogani from Axis Capital. Please go ahead.
My first question is with regards to the Africa. Hello? Am I audible?
Yeah, go ahead.
So my first question is with regards to the Africa region. How has been the performance there tracking now? I mean, due to COVID, and what's the outlook there overall basis?
Gaurav, I think BVK will explain to you more in detail. I think in general it has been good and maintaining the same as what it was as far as earlier. BVK will give you the specifics in terms of, you know, the Africa number and how we are doing. And I think the outlook going forward is stable. Go ahead.
Yeah. So actually, you know, prior to COVID, now we were doing a very good quantity, that is almost, you know, 80,000 liters. So last year, you know, we have done around 56,000 liters, and this year, you know, we are trailing around 50,000 liters close. Maybe because of COVID, maybe slightly they are also going to improve from this month onwards. Look like.
Are we able? Do we have the confidence like we will be able to reach to the 80,000 liters, or we are purposely keeping it to a lower level as of now?
Maybe, you know, slightly it will go up around 60-65,000 liters we are forecasting this year.
Okay, so better than the last year, but historical lower. And sir, my next question is also a follow-up to the previous question of the participant in terms of the margins, I would say. So like we had seen a sharp, you know, increase in margins in FY21, and that was largely led due to the sharp gross margin expansion that we witnessed. And now as the stability in the overall revenue comes and the demand starts picking up, there would be an increase in the procurement prices as well, which might have an impact on the gross margins. So what kind of a steady state margin, you know, one should look in a dairy business overall with a slight increase in the value-added product mix?
Gaurav, like we said earlier, right, and we've been saying that all along, I think we have, you know, yes, we saw a sharp margin increase in the previous year of COVID, and now what we are seeing will be the steady state margin as we go forward. As I said, in the, you know, double digits is what we will target and keep going going ahead. So definitely the improvement over the pre-COVID years of the 1920s is now a thing of the past. Going forward, it will not be the same as the 21, but we'll definitely be improved in the double-digit range of the margins as we go forward.
So that would be console basis double-digit that you would be targeting?
Yeah, console basis double-digit. Yeah, console basis double-digits will be there. No, minor here and there can be there, but we will be in the double-digits.
Okay. So that's all for me. Thanks.
Thanks, Gaurav.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Bharat Kotari. Please go ahead.
Hello. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for the opportunity, sir. I have a couple of questions. First question I have, means this question is a little high level. How do you vision your company after, let's say, 5 years? Means additional state-wise, additional milk capacity, or how do you vision your company, this company after, let's say, 5 years? This is the first question, and second, okay, carry on.
Go ahead. Ask the question, I'll answer both. Go ahead.
And the second question I have is how this industry goes through the capex cycle. Let's say, what is your yearly capex plan for this year, next few years? That is the third. And if I can just choose another question, how is your online milk sale, like BB Daily or Big Basket Daily, Milk Bazaar, and all this? Because this is a new area. Means my I'm giving my personal experience. I bought milk from BB Daily. So how do cater to that line of business? So sorry, might be I pushed three questions. If you can answer those, thank you.
Thank you so much, Bharat sir. We look at it, I'll take it from the online to start with, sir. And when you look at it from the online presence, we are also, you know, trying to go onto the platforms where we are available on the platforms, you know, like if we take Super and the Spur in the areas where we are. Whether we will create our own platform, right now when we look at the economics of creating our own platform, it is not yet viable. So therefore, we are on other common platforms which are available. But I think in the coming future, it will be another distribution channel which all of us will pick on. But we are very cautious about not to have a burn rate that goes forward. We partner with other channel distributors who are there and then try to go on to that. So it's an ongoing affair where we have to keep looking at it, and we cannot ignore the fact we will be there and we'll continue to grow with that. Regarding our capex cycle, sir, we have what we call as a regular capex cycle, one on the plant side which we keep because we have multiple plants, the older ones and the newer ones, some of them will be upgrading and all that, which will be a smaller cost, maybe 5 crores, 10 crores per annum is what will be the cost of keeping these plants up and going. We have a second major chunk of whenever we grow, because we have to manage our sales and procurement in tandem. We have to increase our chilling center capacity in tandem with our sales growth. That is where we will deploy another 20, 30 crores at the most per annum. Right now, we have built enough capacity for our immediate future of 2 to 3 years of marketing and expenses. Therefore, we don't see any other major capital outflow coming from the greenfields. We are always on the lookout for good value if we get an opportunity at the M&A side. But we will not go into it for the sake of going into it. Only if the value is right for us, we think it adds value accretion to us, is when we will go for. But we are very actively looking out even there. Looking at the 5 years, sir, I think for my dream personally to look at it and the team that we are sitting here, We want to build a company which has a sustained growth. We are not looking at it as a short-term business, but we will look at it as a company which grows sustainable, grows continuously over a period of time, which is, you know, to build a better process, system, people, manpower. I personally believe the business has a lot more room and headroom for us to grow, and it's how we can grow sustainably is where we look at, sir. So in the 5 years, if you look at our growth trajectory of the past, although the basis was smaller, we will continue to maintain similar or little better growth trajectories as we go forward, although the base has become larger. We will still maintain that larger, at a larger base, the same growth trajectory, and we'll continue to grow.
Thank you so much for all the answers. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, we would like to remind participants that you may press star and want to ask a question. The next question is on the line of Rishabh Kapadia. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Sir, I would just like to understand, how do you see the expansion in the non-South states?
We think that we still have a lot more to accomplish in the southern states itself, because what happens is, it's unlike Africa where we went there because there was a huge margin profile. If we find that opportunity of a huge margin profile in the other states, we'll go there. Otherwise, we will do this contiguous growth and cover areas where we are operating, which makes us more cost effective. Now, to have a disjointed for us will not make us very cost effective. Therefore, we look at it only if we get us a good opportunity or a sizable opportunity, which can, at a standalone basis, give us good return. Otherwise, we will not move. We will go through this contiguous improve and then keep adding states. We still have enough to fill in the southern states and the Maharashtra as a state. We still have enough of volume to fill there itself. We rather fill those and then go to the other states.
Understood, sir. And then, sir, since we are more focused on the South Indian states, then what do you think is the situation in Tamil Nadu with the price reduction by the cooperatives, sir? How do you see that panning out?
So I'll explain it in my way, and we will give you more details. So we have been facing this for the past 10 years. I think the peak difference we have seen earlier days was almost a 10 rupee difference between the cooperative and the private sector. And at one point of time, the cooperative took the leap of 10 rupees, and we still continue to go there. So that is how we look at it. They're still able to get a little bit of market growth, continue to grow in Tamil Nadu with quality and this, and price is not playing a major role. BVK will also add to that.
Yeah. See, they've done it, after elections, the new CM, he made it, 3 rupees, 4 rupees, reduction. But, there's not much of impact. Because, the consumers are already, habituated that, that all the private brands, the pricing is the highest comparatively average. The other side, they're almost 6 months due to the farmers, the procurement end.
So this will be very difficult for them to maintain this status.
So after some time, again, they do some kind of jugglery.
Understood. Yes, sir. And one more question, if I may ask, sir. What is the update of the cattle feed business, Orga feed, and the revenue and profitability, etc.? I mean, if you can share an outlook for the next 3 to 5 years for this business, sir.
So, yes, sir. See, actually, Orga feed we acquired only 2019 end. So, actual operations we have done only 2020-21. 2021 we have done roughly about 23-24 top line and around 12% EBITDA. Now this year, since April, our numbers are very good. So almost, 70-80%, capacity we are utilizing. And we are expecting around, 35 crores top line this year. That is the target we have taken.
And so this is Sunil here. And I think after this year, we'll be reaching our full capacity. We'll have to be expanding also. We'll be expanding as we go forward. So maybe in another location, we're looking at it to probe around it.
Great, sir. Great. Thank you very much. Wish you all the best on your endeavors, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, anyone wishing to ask a question, may please press star and one. As there are no further questions, I now hand the conference over to Mr. Rishabh Kapadia for his closing comments.
Thank you, Lizan. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for being a part of this very interactive session. I would also like to thank the management for patiently answering all the queries. Thank you very much and have a nice day.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks, Rishabh. Thank you, Rishabh.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of ICICI Securities, that concludes this conference call. We thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines. Thank you.